Rise and Shine Rwanda.
Good morning. You're watching Rise and Shine Rwanda with me, Ivan Magwene.
And me, Peace Kwizera. Coming up on Rise and Shine.
Rwanda looks to close the orphanage. We see how far this plan has come.
Kurema Kureba Kwiga Art Initiative launches the Kigali portal.
And in sports, Leicester City crowned English Premier League champions.
Ghana becomes a visa-free country for Africans.
Good morning out to you all, and I hope you're having a very nice week. And of course, I hope you guys had a very nice week as we're trying to, you know, launch again and, you know, bring up the news again to the people. So how's the week been for you, starting from Chantal?
Well, it's been work. Yeah, you know, but always, because I do what I love, then it has been perfect for me.
So, okay. Peace, how has it been for you
for the past few days? It has been amazing. It has been amazing. It has been amazing being here on the show especially, and I hope it's also amazing for the viewers who are watching us.
Steven?
Well, it's amazing being on set, but yeah, I've also enjoyed the background work. It's challenging, but yeah, it makes me feel like, you know, I'm alive.
All right. Well, another thing I think also people, for our viewers out there also, you know, it's been a new week for us, and you know, we're trying to give you all the best, and we hope, you know, you can bring in your feedback and let us know what you think of our new start, which I think we're pretty much doing very well. We're trying. Of course, it has not been easy, but, you know, we're just trying. And of course, before we go any further, we're going to bring you all the latest local stories, international and regional stories. We'll be right back. And now starting off with a local story. Now, the Minister for Infrastructure, Honorable James Musoni, has said negotiations are in advanced stages with entities that can upgrade water networks in Kigali and six secondary cities across the country. The minister says the move will see the water networks manageable using computer or phone-based systems. People, now when I looked at this story, I imagined what kind of city would have. First of all, integrating the water system into what we'd call a smart-based system.
Yes.
And as you already know, we've been facing issues with our water system. And I think WASAC somehow, somewhere, is trying to improve the situation.
Yes.
And in one way or the other, this comes as a right solution, especially in terms of the way we manage our water system, the sewage system, and how clean our water is, and how easy are we able to access the water. I will start off with Stephen, how you see this initiative already.
Well, I read that article in the New Times.
Yes.
There's one thing, however, I didn't see. I'm sorry if I'm sidestepping.
Yes. No.
But there's the issue of bill collections.
Mm-hmm.
Well, previously there was a hassle with bill collections, where you find they take some months to bring your bill, and then they give you a notice of like 2 days, then they disconnect you. But I think it looks like now they are really trying to do something to solve that. And yeah, this is positive, because really you can't live anywhere without water. So yeah, kudos.
All right, now, of course, peace. I mean, okay, you have to. Peace. And now, of course, moving on to another second story, leaving out that one, maybe one thing I would say before we go into our second story is the issue of WASAC. I think WASAC has been doing a better job than last year's. I think we need to commend them for that, because at least, and eventually they recently won some award from, I don't know, I don't remember
Abu Dhabi
some. Abu Dhabi Global, something awards because of their services, which I think is a very good initiative, and this shows that there's been improvement. And if you look at the services we're receiving in our homes, at least water now has kind of increased. The volumes of what we get every week has kind of increased, and I think we should thank them for that.
Yeah, they did a great job actually.
Yes. Now moving on to the second story. Well, it's quite a sad story that we've been reporting. These stories that are very, very, very sad. Now the drama of Magic System. Magic System is a very popular band. But before I go any further, maybe for people who don't know what I'm talking about, I'd let you watch a little bit of what we're talking about. Yeah. Take a look. Yeah. well to every African, everywhere you are, let it be in the US or China, whenever this tune comes in, you have to, you know, wherever you are, you have to stand up and dance to this song. Premier Gau was the song of the days, is always going to be the song of the generation.
Yes.
Now, people, very sad news to report to you is that their band, their drummer, one of the people that contributed a lot to this beat, Didier Diena, who was 46, actually died. And this is very sad because he died, he drowned, he died at a beach in the small town of Jacquesville in southern Ivory Coast on Sunday. Pepito's tragic loss comes a week after the sudden death of influential Congolese musician Papa Wemba. Now, of course, I think you know a lot about Magic System. Magic System, yeah, let it be even in East Africa. Magic System is a very big group in West Africa.
Yes.
But of course, maybe I'll bring it on to the lifestyle segment here to give us a little more light about this. But I think this is a very quite sad story.
It's always sad, you know, talking about, you know, having to report, you know, the cases of people who have died. And, well, the Magic System, growing up, like, we heard them, and they were amazing, you know, they were amazing. You stand up and dance to any of their tunes, and and usually the drummer is known to be the heart of the band, usually, like, from all the bands that I've seen. They give you the beat, and then you can follow on. But it's always sad, you know, reporting news like this, but also I kind of have, you know, to wonder why it's cases in Ivory Coast. I mean, I'm not just saying it's because of that, but like, isn't it quite? Anyway, I'm sorry. Mine might be, you know, being
please,
a little
let me
bit.
Bring up a little point. Well, Papito, I think that was his nickname. He died trying to save somebody from drowning. So, I mean, according to me, he's a hero. And I think maybe we should celebrate his life. Okay, we should be sad also, but we should celebrate his life.
Yeah, true.
So, Shanta, any memories of the Premier Gau or whatever, any memories of the Magic System that you think maybe at this time should be bonding together the fans and the music?
What do you think? Definitely. The memories are there and they always stay. I'm so saddened by his death, of course. That those are the groups that, those are the bands actually that were there when we were growing up. And it's like they made our childhood enjoyable. So it's really sad that we get to lose this person in Abuja after losing Papa Wemba in the same city. It feels like there's something wrong. But anyway, the Lord gives and he has taken away.
And of course, to our viewers out there, we've lost, of course, a truly good son of music in Africa. And we hope that Magic System stands strong because fans are really standing strong. Now to a more lighting story. Of course, it has been the buzz of the international news. It has been the buzz of the sports world. Leicester City are finally crowned the champions of the English Premier League. People, can you believe that? I still cannot believe it. Stephen, I swear to God, I cannot believe Leicester City are champions. Stephen.
Well, I'll take I'm a Tottenham fan.
I don't want, I want to just make me believe
that. I'm just giving you a picture. But deep down inside, I wanted that story too. And like that. I mean, a part of me. I'm sad, okay, we lost Tottenham. But yeah, I mean, Leicester, you know, that the way they started the season, everybody had written them off. They were relegation candidates last season. And this season, everybody had predicted they would be relegated. But they turned it around and become champions. I mean, that's really makes us love the Premiership more because it's so unpredictable. There's so much drama. But I'm really happy about it. I don't know, maybe you can tell me what really coach.
Well, for me, like, before we even go any further, I would love the director maybe to a little bit show people how happy the team was and how this played out as they were waiting for their final moment when Tottenham was playing off with Chelsea. Let's take a look. I think you saw it over there. It was total, you know. I think for people out there, of course, for people out there to understand, even the ladies now understand what is Leicester City.
Of course, outside,
you understand what's Leicester City.
Yes.
But any case of what you've learned from Leicester City's win of the English Premier League?
Well, I have learned not to give up, you know. The previous seasons, Leicester wasn't among, you know, the winning teams. You know, as the girls are usually never fans of, you know, football. But we never really had, you know, this team before. Yeah. And then out of the blue, we just hear it coming. We're talking about it on the show a few weeks ago. Mm. And, you know, it's quite funny because, you know, coming, it teaches me that, you know, you never have to give up. You only have to work harder. And this is such an inspiration to me and to the rest of, you know, football teams that are coming up because you don't ever have to give up, whether, you know, there are people who are, you know, older than you or they are more experienced. You have to keep doing what you love and even do it better.
I know Stephen is burning up because he's from the sports world, but I would love you. I would love to know Shanta's own perspective on this issue.
A lady throws light on soccer. I mean, how weird.
Special moment.
Well, am I a big soccer fan? No. Mm-hmm. But working with you and Steven, how can I not know about Leicester City?
Absolutely.
And it has been amazing. Mm-hmm. And that teaches me not to even listen to what people say. You know, you can listen, but don't put it into practice. Yeah. Put into practice what you have to do, like what your heart tells you to do. Mm-hmm. So these guys came from zero to somewhere, to the top, actually. Mm-hmm. I think the whole of England is going to be burning. I don't know.
Of course. Now, of course, just like Drake said, it started from the bottom. Now
we're here.
Now, of course, for our fans out there, it's possible. If Leicester City can do it, you personally can do it. Now, of course, with that drama said of what is Leicester City doing, and congratulations, of course, to the Leicester City fans, of which there are still very few.
I think but now eventually, I'm going to be a fan.
Yeah.
Now is the time to pick a team.
Yeah.
Are you in with me?
Picking a team, well, it's going to be quite a hard one. But I think Leicester has taught me something. And I think this is going to kind of be my team from now on.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, if we can't beat them, then join them.
True.
Now, of course, that's all we had for news. But, of course, we have the hot topics. And I'll leave out to Peace to take it out from there. Peace, what do you have for us there?
Well, I have plenty for you guys today. Mm-hmm. And I'm excited, you know, to be talking about the hot topics today. But starting with Miss Concord Dorian, she was among the 12 contestants who battled it out for the Miss Africa Continent crown in a colorful ceremony that was held in Johannesburg. And this is quite interesting because, you know, I mean, she did not come off as the winner, sadly, but I'm so glad that, you know, she went out and represented Rwanda. Mm. And in the beginning, there were over 40 contestants, and somehow Rwanda was, you know, selected among the 12, you know, countries to represent. And I'm excited, you know, because she went out there and then she did what she loved doing. Mm. And she represented Rwanda, and somehow we are on the map of the contestants, you know, who went. But what do you guys have to say about this? I mean, Stephen.
Well, here she was, before she went to South Africa. Okay, I'm sorry to throw a blanket on everything, but she wasn't really in the news a lot. But the fact that, you know, we were all waiting, like, what's next for the re- And she comes up with this. She's in the top 12 girls in Africa. That's a comeback. I mean, it's really, you know, that's story young for you.
And for me, I think for me, this is what was more interesting, is that actually Rwandans took their part, I think, even in the voting. I mean, normally Rwandans don't like online voting, but I saw Concord Dorian was at least until the final day, the second leading, of course, after Nigeria. Mm. But I saw something that Rwandans actually supported her, and I love to appreciate that. And even if she didn't bring back the crown, I think she did a great job. Even being among the top 12 contestants, and not forgetting, I think she was the most beautiful.
We need to support her. She is the most beautiful and I'm actually proud of her that she managed to even get there. It puts Rwanda on the map, just like you said. And for her not to bring the crown home, I can't blame her. Maybe she gave it her 100%. Maybe that wasn't her time. You know, You can't have everything like this. The graph is not straight always. But kudos to her for making it wherever she is.
And that's we'll have to vote some more.
And sometimes it's never, you know, about the voting or anything. Sometimes, you know, it's just not where your blessing is. Mm-hmm. You know, let's just...
Exactly.
Well, I can say I have like a little bit of experience.
She's talking from experience.
I'm talking from experience. But I love being here. Yeah. You know, I love working here. Yeah. This is something that I enjoy doing.
Yes.
And, you know, if maybe I was crowned or something, I'd be off doing, you know, different projects.
Something.
But working here makes me do, you know, different projects on the side. And, you know, maybe a blessing is always, you know, in the, you know,
there's
in
always
the back
an opportunity.
Somewhere. So maybe she'll be an amazing, you know, BBC Africa presenter in the future or something. But maybe this is not where her blessing is.
Yeah.
But Kungwa, you did a great job and we're so proud of you here. And we want to congratulate you for, you know, representing us and being the best that you could be.
Definitely. Yeah. There are lots of it.
But moving on, and I'm excited about this one. Mm-hmm. Ghana has approved free visa for all African citizens entering Ghana. Who's excited?
I'm so excited.
You know, now I can just start saving up to go to Accra, you know, over maybe holidays or something. But what does this mean? It means all of you can actually start going to Accra. Visa free, like you don't have to, you know, go in and look for a visa and go through applying and, you know, going through all that trouble. I want to know what your take is on.
Actually, for me, I think this whole idea of having no visa, I think this, Ghana just opened up this whole topic. I think Africans should never get visas to visit fellow African countries. Mm-hmm. And Ghana just opened up this. And I think Ghana is going to be one of the most beautiful places people could ever visit.
Could
it has one of the
visit,
biggest
true.
Historical cities. Mm. Of course, there's a lot of cities in Ghana you can visit apart from Accra. Mm. There's a lot of things you can visit up in Accra. But most important, I think, this also is the fact that with Ghana being the founding father of what I would call Pan-Africanism,
yes.
I think this is a very good move, and I would like to appreciate the leaders of Ghana for doing this.
True.
That's really a good movement. Yeah, hopefully we're going to see other African countries taking suit, because the only African country that has that policy, I think, must be Seychelles.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, but notice one thing between Seychelles and Ghana, they are also holiday destinations.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it's good for their tourism. Mm-hmm. I think, well, maybe Rwanda, if we want to maximize on our tourism, you know, we can.
Yeah, maybe I think time will come for that, and you know, Africa will just be one beautiful continent where Africans, you know, I'm not
Africans
being mean or anything,
Africa.
But I feel like this should just go to us. It's our privilege.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're like on a cabinet and you have your specific privileges, I think that should be, you know, for us. And you know, the rest should bring in, you know, the funds and should help us out. But that's all we had for you for Hot Topics today. We'll be right back with the story of the day.
Welcome back to Rise and Shine Rwanda, of course, with me, Ivan Magwene. Now it's time for your story of the day. Now, 4 years ago, Rwanda took the radical decision to begin shutting down all its orphanages, a move that would have made it the first country in Africa to do so. As you all know, the 1994 genocide against the Tutsi had left the country with thousands of orphans. Following the killings, foreign aid organizations set up dozens of orphanages, with the number of institutions in the country raising from 3 to 34. In 2012, the government announced that by the end of 2014, all of these orphanages would be closed. The move followed a United Nations declaration that every child has the right to grow up in a family. And actually, research showed that 70% of the children in care in Rwanda still had families. So tonight, the question is, how far has the nation gone on this same decision of actually closing down and saving the vulnerable? As you already know, this is not a new topic. For me, when I first saw this back in 2012, there was a lot of debate going on.
Yes.
And the debate was, indeed, should we close down the orphanages? Is it really necessary? According to the argument made by the United Nations and all the other organizations, Save the Children and all the other organizations, is that we should, every child has a right to grow up in a family. Every child has a right to certain needs, but because they're not in a family, they're not able to get all those needs. So, of course, just like every child, it's very good to grow up in a family where you feel loved and you're given certain things that will help you be the kind of person that they want you to be in future.
Yeah.
But in your own opinion, would you say that the decision right now is, of course, this has been extended a little bit because these orphanages were never closed, so mm-hmm. there's still a lot of discussion going on and trying to set up the children in different families. But if you look at this, what do you think so far should be the solution?
Well, I think orphanages should be left open. Mm-hmm. Reason being, we're in Rwanda. Mm-hmm. We're Africans. We've all had our tragedies in the past, the history. True. And who is ready? Yeah? How many parents, Randy's parents, are ready to offer a homeless child a home mm-hmm. and be the family that the child needs? I don't think the Rwandans are really ready, to be honest on this point. Mm-hmm. I don't think very many Rwandan families are ready, yet we have very many
Shanta, when
orphans.
Will Rwandans be ready to host all of them?
I think we need more sensitization mm-hmm. and we have to be taught each and every day. Or else we can leave the orphanages and employ people who will be their parents. After mm-hmm. all, that is why they are put there. Mm-hmm. So sure. I don't think people are like, they really want to bring in those kids. Mm-hmm. I don't think they are ready enough. They really need
to. Of course, I would love this to be
yes.
a conflict of ideas.
It's
of
still a debate.
Yes, it's a
I
very
have something
debate.
To say against yes. You know what Chantal has said. You
yes.
said they should be kept open. But according to the findings, some of these children, they have families, they have parents, mm-hmm. but they don't want to look after them. Mm-hmm. So sometimes, okay, they are forced to, they are taken back mm-hmm. home to mm-hmm. families that where they have maybe issues, where they don't love them.
Exactly.
So it's really, okay, in my own view, it's mm. really, there's a lot of that needs to be considered because mm. either way it's a hard situation. Mm-hmm. But the point about creating awareness, mm. I think maybe
they
drive to encourage families to show that loving, to encourage the families,
yes.
I think it would be. Do
peace. Now, this is the problem. This is the argument I want us to understand. First mm. of all, the argument is these kids, whenever they're in the orphanages, mm. you know, the situation is not as easy as it seems it to be.
Yeah,
first
of
all, they're not given their rights. They're not receiving the rights they're supposed to be given. Even the fact that they're even in an orphanage, it's not supposed to be there in the first place. Mm-hmm. And what we're trying to do them is raise them into a Rwandan family, mm. of which I think is of good privilege. Why on earth would you say that's actually a bad idea right now? If it's a bad idea, when do you think it's going to be a better idea? After how many years? Because again, you need to also talk about certain things that as you criticize them, but
yes.
also give a very realizable idea that this can be implemented. What would you say, Peace?
Well, I think the kids usually grow so much fond of each other, mm-hmm. and they're not really doing bad in the orphanages where mm-hmm. they are, because mm-hmm. this is where people go and, you know, they help them, and then, they, you know, people go visit them, and they feel somehow loved. They have everything that they need. Now, I'm not just saying that, you know, they don't need to go on to homes. It's also a good, you know, deal to go into homes and, you know, have parents. But some of these kids grow up to become siblings, mm-hmm. you know, they bond, you know, mm-hmm. to become siblings. And once
yes.
they're separated, they lose that, you know, part of them. It's like being separated with your, you know, siblings. So
yeah.
it's quite something. It's a debate that mm. should go on, and people should think about it first. But for now, like, let's just see what happens.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let's see what just happens. But what do you think needs to happen right now? Should we also opt to say that no to these orphanages anymore? What's your take?
My take is I think we should say yes to the orphanages, mm-hmm. but also say yes to the homes. I'm not mm-hmm. saying orphanages should completely go off. But
undecisive.
Also, yeah.
All right.
I'm undecisive.
Okay.
Well, it's a complicated issue. Just like you see, we all have different views,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. but I'm sure you know we'll come up with a solution.
All right,
yeah.
Of course, we wrap up from there as you had it. But of course, this discussion continues. And of course, it is of course our own, you know, wish that every child is able to grow up in a family. And to let's work as a Rwandan society as we have to grow the children of this country.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you've been watching Rise and Shine Rwanda. Stay with us. Wera Chantal is up next with business.
Here is to traveling and saving. Starting 1st of April to the 1st of June, travel with Rwandair and take advantage of our reduced fares and enjoy our world-class services in great comfort and safety.
Fly our dream to the heart of Africa.
Welcome back.
Business stories making headlines today. How to boost Made in Rwanda campaign. Rwanda launched a campaign to promote consumption of locally made products over a year ago. Made in Rwanda campaign also focuses on improving product quality, especially among small and medium enterprises, to spur export volume and receipts. The small and medium sector makes up over 98% of the total businesses in Rwanda, making it a significant player in the economy. All cars older than 4 years of fresh for fresh inspection. All vehicles more than 4 years old will be required to undergo mandatory inspection after the government released rules on the vetting aimed at removing unroadworthy cars from roads. The draft rules released by the National Transport Safety Authority for public review require private vehicles to be inspected every 2 years and commercial vehicles annually. Private car owners will pay between 2,600 shillings and 3,900 shillings for the checks depending on the vehicle engine. Nigeria property boom follows Boko Haram retreat. Investors scramble for land in Maiduguri in Borno State, where prices have more than doubled in recent years. Property investors in the Nigerian city of Maiduguri are benefiting from a rise in the real estate prices following the retreat of Boko Haram fighters. Maiduguri is the largest city in Borno State, once a stronghold of the fighters and a frequent target of its suicide bombers. The group claims to be fighting against Western influence, as it's thought to have killed about 15,000 people and driven more than 2 million from their homes during a six-year insurgency. Imagine entering a room where you're connected to someone from another continent. Visible, audible, and in real time. This is what Kigali Portal is all about. Unlike other social platforms introduced before, the portal was launched officially on April 30th in Kigali and held live visual communication. We were there to get the details. Please take a look. It was a cool Saturday evening when people from all over the city gathered at the Impact Hub Kigali's shared studios to experience the Kigali Portal. The first of its kind in Kigali was organized by the Kurema Kureba Kwiga, a public art initiative, and was aimed at fusing art and technology. And we spoke to Judith Ken, the lead organizer, and here's what she had to say.
One thing about the portal, the Kigali portal, briefly. The Kigali portal has joined a network of portals around the world. They are converted spaces, typically a shipping container. In this case, we are in the conference room of Impact Hub in Kigali. But the idea is that a user in one city physically enters this space, and then somebody else in another city, somewhere else around the world, physically enters an identical space. And then through technology, they're able to connect digitally and talk to one another and meet each other and learn about each other and share aspects of their culture or their interests and form a new connection. So we call this an unexpected encounter. So the idea with the Kigali portal is our hope is that this is a temporary location and that we ultimately move and have a physical shipping container. They're all painted gold. And we want to ultimately position this like maybe in the car-free zone or in front of the library or the parking lot of the stadium so that it is a truly public platform that anybody can access. We're talking to people from all walks of life, from all parts of the world, about anything that anybody wants to talk about. Sure. I think that there are certain ways that we could generate revenue from this, turn it into something
more sustainable than it currently is. Perhaps that means that if, for example, a coffee company, an agriculture company here who works with Rwandese farmers, they want to connect their team to an organization or a group of students or other stakeholders elsewhere, that they could pay a fee to us to curate that experience so that they can help us sustain our costs, which include paying for hosts, paying for internet, physical space, etc. This is just one idea. I'm very open to alternative ideas as well. Yeah. Thank you so much.
You too.
Hello, how are you? Please tell us your name.
I'm good. Yeah.
What's your name?
My name is Kirenga. Karengera. Eric Soul. People call me Eric Soul as an artist, but my name is Eric Karengera. Yeah, I'm a creative colleague of the organizers, and yeah, you know, kind of supporting each other's stuff. And today I'm going to be here to be experiencing the portal, which is an amazing, amazing thing going on in Kigali, and DJing a little bit later on.
How do you find it so far? Is it exciting?
What do you think? I think it's amazing. I think it's great for Kigali. I think it's great that we're connecting into a global art initiative that's using art and technology. You know, we talk about a lot in Rwanda about ICT, and there's another conversation somewhere else talking about the growth of the creative sector, the creative economy, and it's one of those events that just bring the two together. And you can see the atmosphere, people are cool, people are relaxed, it's diverse, they come from everywhere, there's like expat, foreigners, diaspora, people from the region, Rwandan locals, there's music, there's art, there's drinks, there's food, it's a very nice gathering.
Thank you so much for sharing.
You're very welcome.
Well, that's all we had for you here at the Kigali Portal launch event. I am Chantal Uwera, Rise and Shine Rwanda.
Well, that's all we had for you in business. Sports is coming up next with Stephen Kalimba.
Welcome back to Rise and Shine Rwanda. It's now time for your sports news. I'm Stephen Kalimba. Bugesera 1 sprint rally set for Saturday. The sprint rally will cover a distance of 120 kilometers with 10 competitive stages. The rally is a long-term plan to promote and attract young and upcoming drivers in the country. It is expected to attract both local and Burundian drivers. Five drivers have confirmed so far to participate. Silverbacks boosted by hiring of step-in coach ahead of the Africa Rugby Division 2 Cup. The Silverbacks have boosted their chances of winning the Africa Rugby Tournament, which kicks off on May 15th at Amahoro Stadium, by hiring the services of former Uganda Titan prop Brian McCallama. McCallama has had a few sessions with the players. He's described them as hardworking, but they need guidance to perform. McCallama played for the Cranes from 2001 to 2010 and was coaching a rugby club in Kenya. He will take over duties alongside Jean-Baptiste Itanze, who has been also the coach. And in Premiership football, talk has been about Leicester City, and Claudio Ranieri has been hailed as the king after winning the Premier League. All over, the Italian has been praised for pulling off an impossible feat after Leicester were crowned champions. This came after Tottenham squandered a 2-0 lead to draw with Chelsea on Tuesday. Leicester will be handed the trophy on Sunday before the game with Everton.
So, Stephen, allow me to say this. Yes. First, these are called the underdogs, the unqualified. Name it. Leicester City are the champions. At this moment, until the end of this show, I don't understand. I want you to clearly bring me now deep into the analysis, mathematically, logistically. How could a team, an underdog like Leicester City, take up the most competitive cup in the world, which is the English Premier League? Stephen.
Well, it beats understanding. And let's not forget that Ranieri, he's been at it for 30 years. This was his first major trophy. So he really pulled some magic for these boys to win the trophy. Mm-hmm. So remember that, okay, let's look at the Leicester squad.
If you look at the years in which Ranieri, you say he was working, actually, it doesn't prove any point that he was the right man to make a team like Leicester City take up the Premier League. So anyway, if you convince me with
remember
that,
remember
yes.
When he arrived, he said the team wasn't, the squad wasn't broken, so he wouldn't fix it. He used nearly the same squad he found. Mm-hmm. Okay, looking at the squad, you see we have some old guys. We have Vardy, who's 30. We have Wes Morgan, who scored the winner against in the previous game, and he's 32. So you have other guys who also they are not like the top. They don't earn as much as the Sami Nasri's and the Rooney's. But he's kept them together. He's given them, there's a time he would tell them, he told them that if you don't concede any goals, I'll give you pizza. Mm-hmm. So he really created an atmosphere. He made a team, to quote, a small team with a big heart. Mm-hmm. And, it's really been amazing.
And I would like to bring it down for me to understand this. This is a team that had what I would call the least inexpensive squad to take the Premier League. Could this mean that we are going to see a revolution of how teams manage, especially in terms of the way they spend their income? Now, is it going to change the tactics of what team managers are going to be doing, especially looking at Leicester City? Because at this point, this is a team that has taken this Premier League with an inexpensive squad, with few logistics compared to the other giants, especially the ones we're used to. For us, explain to me that once, in terms of, I want you to bring it bit by bit as somebody who has been following up Leicester City's journey.
Well, to bring it in figures, they had the paid staff 57 million pounds. Compared to the other teams like Chelsea, like Manchester City, for them, really, they had a lot of money. I mean, £300 million.
Mm-hmm.
So, we're looking at the squad. I go back to the squad again.
Mm-hmm.
The way this is a squad that is made up of people who've been kicked around in soccer.
Mm-hmm.
But so it's been like their past histories. I mean, they felt like they had something in common,
so and
they bonded,
mm-hmm.
and it's really been, a fairy tale.
Mm-hmm.
But looking at the finances, well, I had talking. There was an interview on Arsene Wenger.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he's somebody who's been in the Champions League and where, but he said, next weekend, next season they have Champions League,
mm-hmm.
and they have, okay, Premier League, they have the FA. So we'll really see really where they would go with, if they maintain this luck.
Mm-hmm.
But again, talking about finances, they'll have to increase the wages of star players.
Absolutely.
Like Vardy, like Kante,
mm-hmm.
and Mahrez, because
mm-hmm.
those were the best players. So really, their finances really have a role,
yes,
to play.
My last question, of course, to our viewers out there, I want you to explain them in a simple journalistic way. If the English Premier League is taken by Leicester City, what does this mean for the team? What are some of the biggest endorsements that we're going to see Leicester City take, especially because they took this cup?
Well, first of all, if they get to the Champions League,
mm-hmm.
well, the Champions, even if they get out at the group stages, that will be 7.3 million pounds.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we have the payments from the Premier League.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they have a fat check waiting up. Then we have the personal bonuses for the coach, Claudio Ranieri. He's going to win. He's going to be paid a bonus of 5 million. Remember, he was promised a bonus of 10,000 pounds
mm-hmm.
every position they win past, they get away from the relegation table.
Yes.
So really, it's a big amount of money. But yeah, they are better off financially right now.
All right, if I ask you one question with one word, how would you describe the win of Leicester City in one word?
It's a fairy tale.
It's a fairy tale.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. And of course, there you heard it from Stephen Kalimba. Of course, congratulations to the Leicester City team and, of course, the fans out there. And we hope to enjoy the season more even as we get to enjoy this win. You are watching Rise and Shine Wonder. Stay with us, of course. Peace Quizera is coming up next with Lifestyle.
Here is to traveling and saving. Starting 1st of April to the 1st of June, travel with Randair and take advantage of our reduced fares and enjoy our world-class services in great comfort and safety.
Fly our dream to the heart of Africa.
Welcome back. It's time for the Lifestyle segment with me, Peace Quizera. Well, those of you who have been wondering where to find the best African fabrics and sandals, we have suggestions for you. Uzuri K&Y is the local store producing some of the most beautiful and quality African sandals. The Rise and Shine team paid a visit to the store, and here's what they came up with. Take a look.
Ikigo cya kitwa Uzuri K&Y Design Limited ni ikigo natangiye gukoramo guturuka mu kwa gatandatu k'umwaka ushize wa 2015. Akaba ari ikigo gikora ibintu bijyanye n'inkweto zo kwambara, amasandari n'ibikapu bikoze biboshye mu dukije umuco wacu wa Kinyarwanda biboshye bikozwe mu bitenge no mu mpu ndetse no muzi materials zikoreshwa mu gukora inkweto kuvuga ngo ni ikigo gikora ibi cyane cyane inkweto z'abadamu iz'abagabo nazo zirakorwa ariko cyane cyane z'abadamu zo twibandaho kuba ari ikigo gikora inkweto nziza zi ku rwego rwiza kandi zikomeye kuvuga ngo inkweto zacu ni inkweto dukoresha intoki ahanini ni ukuvuga ngo ni inkweto iba yitondewe ntabwo ari inkweto ivuga ngo yabaye produise na mashine komite ibintu bashyiramo bigakorwa ni ibintu dukora etape by etape dukoresheje intoki bityo tukabamo kwitonderwa akaba ari ikintu gisohoka cyitwa bifu ni gikomeye cyuje ubuziranenge mbese natwe ubwacu turabitestinga tukabyambaraho tugakora tuzambaye benshi muri twaba bazambaye mu mirimo yo mu rugo turazambara tukatestinga mbere y'uko tujyana kuri marshe tukareba se ibintu dukora birakomeye bifite garanti twamara kubona ko icyo kintu gikwiye kuba cyakonsuma intoki dutamazwe kuri karite tukajyana ku isoko abantu bakagikunda ni ukuvuga ngo inkweto zacu zirakundwa bitewe n'uburyo zikomera ndetse n'ubwiza bwazo
nkaba nkora ibijyanye n'inkweto nzi no gukora n'ibijyanye n'amasakoshi nkaba nshinzwe kwigisha abo mubona hano bari hano bose ninjye wabigisha ibyo gukora inkweto hano muri buzuri mpamaze umwaka nkorana na Kevin na Shimwe twatangiranye turi batatu baza bansanga mu rugo hano ari nkwiga hanga ibintu rero ni ibintu n'umwuga mwiza ndawukunda cyane wafashije kurihira abana hari abana afite batatu barangije amashuri yafashije kubarihirira ndubatse nta hantu heza hafatika kandi nkabona n'icyo kurya ariko cyane kinshimisha cyane ni ukuba ubwo uyu mwuga mbashe kuzawugeza ku bantu bangana gutya kugira ngo bizagire icyo bizabafasha hano muri iyo buzuri rero nkampari kugira ngo iyi buzuri yacu turebe ko yaba uruganda koko rufite imbaraga kandi turabyifuza kandi tuzabigeramo
Well, please, that is some interesting stuff I've seen.
I know.
Oh, my God. Who knew Rwandans could get that far?
I know. It's crazy. I was looking at them myself, and I was like, oh, my God. Mm. Oh, my God. Is this made from here, or it's made from somewhere else? I'm excited that, you know, something like this has finally come to Rwanda, and now we can just go shop made in Rwanda things.
I think at some point we are going to have to stop importing shoes.
True, they're quite interesting and they're very strong. By the way, I've had a pair for over, longer than I've had any other pair of shoes.
Yeah, sure.
So longer than they are, longer than 2 years, they're still there and they're still fine. Oh. So, you know, it's quite interesting.
So how are the prices generally? You know, made in Rwanda things usually tend to have a higher price. Mm-hmm. So how are the prices of the shoes?
The prices there are very, very affordable, you know. Depending, you know, having a shoe for more than 2 years is, you know, quite something. So, yes. You know, if they put a price on it, you know, you don't have to keep buying new ones if they're good quality especially. So the prices are quite affordable. You know, you should go check them out yourself.
I will, definitely. I will. I can't wait.
Yeah.
So if I may ask, how is the demand and how do they actually cope with the demand? Are Rwandans buying this in larger quantities? And how do they cope with it? Because they have to make them and sell them. So how does it go?
Well, the demand is quite there. Mm-hmm. But of course, you know, it's a business and there is always, you know, that need for more, you know, consumption. So, yeah, they definitely need more people to go out there and, you know, and look and even order for what they want. You know, you have the choice of ordering or drawing the kind of shoe that you want if you're, you know, artistic.
Yes.
And they can make it, you know, for you.
Oh.
They're very, 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 you know, artistic. So, yeah, that's great. But the prices are definitely affordable.
Okay, so do they only sell to Rwandans or the people in Kigali or they even kind of sell
outside? It's expanding, you know, it goes on expanding. There is market, you know, in other countries as well. So, yeah, but for now, you know, the main, you know, places here in Rwanda. But you know, they go on, you know, exporting as time goes on. But for now,
sure, because we've had some things being made in Rwanda and actually having branches outside Rwanda. For example, in Kampala, there are some Rwandan boutiques there.
Yeah, true.
And it's really amazing.
I know. It's we're getting there slowly by slowly. I love the fact that, you know, that the industry is, you know, becoming bigger, you know, from Rwanda. And you know, that's not something that we've had over the years, you know, of us growing up. So, you know, I'm quite happy that, you know, something like this has come, you know, to us. Yeah.
Okay, so one last question. Then do you see any future plans from them? Like, what are their future plans? Have you tried to look into that?
Well, I see them going far. You know, I have seen the kind of shoes that they make, and I've seen how beautiful they are, and they're very good at, you know, renovating things, you know. They go on getting better and better. So I see them staying in market. It's not something that you sell because they're, you know, this one type of thing and it will just stay there and it will be the same. And then new things will come along and the people will go to that. I see them, you know, expanding with, you know, generations that will come after. So you better go and get yourself a pair before so that, you know, you're one of their main customers before they expand on you.
I have to shine.
Definitely.
In the Rwandan made style.
Definitely.
Okay, thank you so much for the details. That's all we had for you in Lifestyle. Please stay tuned. We'll be back after the break.
Well, that's all we had for you today. But don't forget, we'd love to hear your thoughts, comments, and feedback on what you're talking about here on Rise and Shine Rwanda. Tweet us at Rise and Shine RW. Like us on our Facebook page and send us your ideas for the program. Check out our Rise and Shine YouTube page where you can catch all the shows that we do and the reports that we do. Find us on Instagram where you can also post your pics. We do love to see those ones. Check out our Rise and Shine website where you can get everything that you need to know about Rise and Shine Rwanda.
Well, that's all we had for you today, but I hope you all guys had a wonderful week.
We did.
Now, starting off from Chantal, how has the experience been for you this week?
Well, it
has
been
great. A comeback, of course.
Exactly. It has been great. I've learned a lot within 1 week, and I'm eager to learn more. I love it. I love the challenging nature of the job. I love every bit of it. It has been great for me.
All right, Peace, how has it been for you?
It has been exciting, every bit of it. You know, I can't take this week back. You know, I loved every single bit of it. This is something that I, you know, definitely see myself getting excited over, you know, to wake up and come and present to you on your breakfast, you know, show. So that's it for me.
All right, Stephen, how has the experience been? Has there been any challenges or quite?
Well, challenges are there, you know. At the beginning is the hardest, but well, one thing that keeps me going is, you know, the excitement. You know, when you tell people that Rise and Shine is back, or like they say, well, we can't wait to see you, and that's really motivating for me. It really makes me come back here and, you know, work.
All right, so
I'm happy.
Well, for our viewers, of course, as you know, we are back now. We're even more, even expanded. We're digital, so you can log on and watch all the shows we are doing. Plus the shows that we have done this week, and let us know what you think about the show. And of course, keep sending in all the feedback, and we hope as we enjoy this show, we get to also wake up as many people as possible, get to connect with many people as possible, and travel with as many people as possible. Now, from, of course, both of us and the rest of this wonderful team, it's been a great week for us, and we hope to see you next time as we're back on the show. But for now, it's goodbye, and of course, we'd love to wish you a nice weekend. We love you all. And we're out. Peace.
Bye-bye.
Bye.